thank you for joining us. Welcome to Grace. We are studying Paul's handbook on faith, his epistle to the assembly at Rome. Paul's been pouring the foundation for us in doctrines relating to that issue of faith. You'll recall the label, I'm sure, that we placed on the first of the four cornerstones found in this faith epistle. This is the cornerstone that scholars call justification, a gift decree of rightness that comes from God to those who place their trust in what his son accomplished where their sins are concerned at Calvary. So Paul's really providing here an answer to the question that Job asked some 1,500 plus years earlier. Job posed the question found in Job 9:2. But how should a man be just with God? The word just, the same word, righteous before God. Answering the question, how is it possible that man be considered just with God, is Paul's purpose in the early going here in the book of Romans. And if you've been following along on our study, perhaps that seems like a good question to you. How can a man be just with God? In fact, things appear rather gloomy. I've heard that from several folks who've been listening. Things appear rather gloomy at this point in Romans. You might say, what a negative message Paul has been delivering thus far. If that's the impression that you've gotten up to this point in our study, you're absolutely right. Paul is painting a gloomy picture at the outset. It's as if Paul's taken on the role of prosecuting attorney, seated at the plaintiff's table, and to illustrate just how bad things really are, Paul wants us to understand that all mankind, that includes you, it includes me, it includes everyone that you and I know, we are all sitting at the table of the defense, in a manner of speaking. So, you see, in this epistle on faith, the very first point that Paul makes as prosecuting attorney is to prove beyond any shadow of a doubt the reality that every man is worthy of the wrath of Almighty God. So we could say that making all of us wrath conscious is point number one in Paul's presentation. We have to understand the charges against us, and that's precisely what Paul set out to do in this first part of Romans. Why is Paul belaboring the point? Because it goes on through the end of the first chapter, or the halfway through the first chapter, we could say, and all the way through chapter 2, into chapter 3. Why is Paul belaboring this point? For very good reason. If we fail to understand that we are sinners by nature, and that we are sinners by choice, and therefore wrath worthy, we'll never fully comprehend, much less appreciate, our need for a substitute redeemer. So Paul's been giving us an awareness here of our own wrath worthiness. If we fail to see ourselves as being wrath worthy, how can we ever understand and appreciate the depths of Christ's words in Matthew 27:46, where he made the statement that, where the statement is made, I should say, Jesus cried with a loud voice, speaking of the crucifixion, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is to say, as the verse goes on to tell us, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some scholars point out that by crying my God two times in the same sentence, that points to the fact that Christ was addressing both God the Father and God the Holy Spirit as he was forsaken by both other members of the Godhead. But the most important thing to understand is, as we read Christ's words here in Matthew, is the magnitude of the event that transpired at Calvary as Christ, the Son of God, God himself, bore the sins of the entire human race in order to redeem mankind from that issue of their sins. It took God himself to redeem wrath-worthy man, and he did so. You see, Paul knew that we would need to recognize our own wrath-worthiness before we would ever be able to comprehend the issue of Christ being forsaken in order to resolve that issue. God's wrath being poured out on the one who was not deserving of that wrath for the sake of those who justly deserve that wrath. And that would be you and I, and as I said, all that we know. That's why Paul, as a wise prosecutor here, has pointed the finger at the entire human race, and he has accused us of being guilty of the crimes of being ungodly and unrighteous. You remember the verse. It was Romans chapter 1, verse 18, where Paul said, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness." Tiny infractions, things that we would think in our relative righteousness reasoning would be very minute. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold or who do indeed possess the truth in unrighteousness. Point the finger at someone and accuse them of something, and what can we expect that person to do? We can expect them to jump up and come to their own defense. Is that not how it works? Almost every case, when it applies to ourselves and somebody accuses us of something, that's precisely what Paul knew mankind would do. Paul knew that the defense mechanism resident within the pride nature of the human heart would be instant in its response to protest the accusation of wrathworthiness. He knew that the human heart would not only be quick, but that it would be ingenious in the pleas that it would offer as to why we are not wrathworthy, why we do not justly deserve God's wrath, and why anyone, much less God, why they would be unfair to think otherwise. Paul anticipated the reaction of the human heart, given the sin nature disease. He anticipated that we would jump to defend ourselves. He anticipated that some men would be quick to defend other men. So he's done what any wise prosecuting attorney would do. He's been eliminating our excuses before we have opportunity to present them. Let me give you at this point the purpose of this entire section we're examining. If you need it for your notes, this goes all the way from chapter 2, verse 1, through chapter 3, verse 20. Here it is, the purpose of the entirety of chapter 2 through chapter 3, once again, is to prove that no one has a self-defense plea that will successfully excuse them from being counted worthy of God's wrath. Let me say it again. No one has a self-defense plea that will successfully excuse them from being counted worthy of God's wrath. No one, therefore, will be able to escape the judgment of God by anything that they do. This is what Paul's been setting out to prove. The necessity of justification, a gift declaration of righteousness by faith. In chapter 1, Paul eliminated the defense plea of ignorance. We saw him put that aside. He said they did indeed know. He then went on to eliminate the self-defense plea of relative righteousness. Well, I'm more righteous than so-and-so that I know. You see, the human heart tries to find a loophole. It tries to excuse itself by measuring its own righteousness relative to the righteousness of others. That's the self-defense plea of relative righteousness, as we called it. It says, the righteousness that I do have in relation to the unrighteousness of others, of course, must be worth something. Therefore, I should be excused from this wrath-worthy status that Paul is proclaiming. But what did Paul have to say about the self-defense plea of relative righteousness? We see it in Romans chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. Therefore, thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest, which is what we all do when we think of being relatively righteous in comparison with crimes others commit, thou that judgest are doing the same things. And we showed how we are doing the same things, but in a different manner. Notice the word things is plural there. Again, if we can find ourselves anywhere in that list that Paul gave, we are wrathworthy. The result, Romans 2:3. Thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? What is the judgment of God? Wrathworthy man. Which is why Paul cried out, O wretched man that I am. According to Paul, the self-defense plea of relative righteousness is not a valid excuse. The issue will not be my righteousness compared to the righteousness of someone else, but my righteousness compared to God's perfect rightness. So relative righteousness will not stand up, we should say, before the bar of God's justice. Paul took a lot of time to prove that. To think otherwise is to be ignorant, it's to be arrogant, and it's to be obstinate, as Paul told us in verses 3, 4, and 5 of chapter 2.